Good morning. I want to show you two small things we do in our company, just to show you interesting ideas. The first is not that, but something different. Because Carlos talked about HTML capabilities yesterday, and I realized that we use that in an interesting way, and perhaps this is something you can think about when you implement something like that. What we use, one moment, what we use is our problem is we have customers and we want to enter lines, and we have about 1,000 products, and all products are similar: big bottles, small bottles, Coke, Coke Light, Coke Zero, and that's very hard to know all the numbers and to know what this customer wants. And for that we introduced this. This is a help screen for our people that is a SQL query that creates an HTML table. And we have an additional window. I can give you a short view. In this window, we can configure that this very same customer uses special wines, and we want to sell these wines. They are important. So that allows us to configure it very easy in a way that when we want to enter this order, our employees see he bought these things, but the green ones are the ones we want to sell. So they are important. First look at that. And we can even give a comment, like sometimes they just say, red wine. That's very hard to know, but we don't want to annoy the customer. Yeah, which wine, and the big bottle or the small? And sometimes a waiter does the ordering and he doesn't really know which wine to use, or the wine from last year, from this year, or whatever. And that is for us important to know which wine we have. And I've seen that you can do really a lot with this help window. And I think that is one of the capabilities of IDMPR that are very powerful, but not obvious to a new user. Yeah, that's one thing I wanted you to show. Questions about that? Okay.
Yeah, how does the implementation of this look like in the SQL code and dictionary?
Yeah, I did that with an SQL function that is quite complex, but yeah, you do it once and then it's easy.
Is this one the same technique that you were showing yesterday with the iframe? In this case, it would be the SQL code that is generating HTML.
Yes, it's similar. Yeah, I did not use the iframe, but yes, you can have iframes there and include external things. That is not an iframe.
Ah, okay.
This is internal. Quick info, yeah, it's quick info. It's nothing special there, but I think quick info can be very powerful, and it's not obvious. That's what I wanted to show. It's nothing really new, just the way we use it. And it was quite hard in SQL to create the tables and to fix that. That's not for a normal user. But we did it in a way that the users can configure what they want, like the colors of green and things like that. Okay. And now I have something more complicated I am doing and thinking about. Calculations and conditions. My problem is the pricing in my company is very complicated. We have about 100 vendors, and every vendor has another philosophy. I think that's the same with very many businesses. And The invoices look very strange. They give discounts per product and discounts per document and discounts if you do this or do that, or if you pick up the things or they deliver. And the price is a very complicated thing to calculate. This is an example I did here, but I think you can imagine that there are hundreds of possibilities. In our business, we have a price list of the brewery, and it says the price per hectoliter. A hectoliter is 100 liters, and a barrel is 50 or 30 liters, or smaller ones. So this price is, we have to calculate it per barrel, and that is something even IDMPR cannot really do today. But when we pick it up with our own truck, we get a discount because they don't have to deliver it to us. And I think that's three things. We have products with like 12 different conditions. Yeah, so this is really a matter in our business. Now I want to do it a bit more complicated, and I tell you that the Köstritzer beer belongs to the Bitburger group, and we can pick it up also at the same place. But they have to bring it from one brewery to the other, and that means they take the same price because it's a similar beer, but they take an additional freight to get it there. So the information I have is, it costs the same, but a bit more. I don't want to have to configure a price with all the Bitburger conditions and add a new one, but I want to know it is the same but a bit different. Yeah. So we have like three concepts here and two concepts there, yeah, five conditions. I call them conditions. So that is everything together. And when I get the invoice, I want to know about that. I want to know why is that the price, so I can control the things. Now they want to add a discount if we pay immediately. That's also normal, and I need that in my calculation too. Yeah, and the question is, who the hell can control that price? In normal IDMPR, I calculate everything and I take the number and do it in my price list. But when something is wrong in the invoices, we get crazy. And the very same is on the other side with our customers. Our business is not about fixed lists, but customers want a discount here or want to talk about that. You know about restaurant owners, and they want every owner wants a special discount in a special way, and that's very complicated. And he calls us and says, you gave me a discount, or the brewery told me I get a discount on Bitburger and not on other beers. Where is the discount? Yeah, and I cannot explain because I have only one price and I don't know how the price was calculated. How can we integrate all that? My idea was to keep every condition, everything I told, every special thing in a single record. But IDMPR uses at very at distinct places in the program, it uses single amounts, like a price list or a price in a line. I have many other ideas for conditions. You can think about that. We use, for example, provisions for business partners. If someone brought us a customer, he gets a provision. We have refunding, like a yearly refund. When the customer has more than a special turnover, he gets money back. And this is also something we need in the calculation, but not in the price. So we have several stages of calculation, And when you want to know if we earn money with that customer, not only the prices on the invoices are important, but also the things we told him he gets back at the end of the year. Yeah. And quantity discounts, we don't use that, but that's another idea. I think you can imagine. So, what I did was something that can do everything. That was the idea. That was a table by condition. And I organized the conditions in stages. That means I can talk about vendors, and I can talk about customers, and I can talk about refunding. So for different places in the code, I can sort them and take the information I need at this moment. The problem, and the real hard problem, is to find a formula that can pick everything of that. Up to now, I use SQL functions for that, and the whole system gets quite complex, but it works. There are two use cases. One is to pick the numbers to get into the invoice, and the other is to explain what we do. Yeah, and I want to do both. Yeah, let's see an example. No, that's One moment. This is one example, and here we have the price for one barrel of Bitburger. You have seen the numbers, but you don't know how that works. That works quite transparently. When I enter a line here, I can enter the same line again. It takes like a third of or half a second. It takes some time. It makes it slower. I have to admit that up to now. A SQL function calculates this value and this value. They are not taken from the price list as in a normal item here, but we changed that. This is from the list. So, okay, that's the price, and I can write my invoice, and everything keeps as you know. So item here is not disturbed in its normal way of working and accounting and whatever. But I want to know how that price is calculated. That is something I'm still not sure. That is a proof of concept. I'm still not sure how to show that. But I found a way using what Carlos explained, the SQL web UI SQL fields and HTML. I did it in a SQL function. So we have like an invoice form here. And that invoice form says the price. Let me scroll that to have it a bit better, yeah? No, the resolution is too small here. That says the price is, this is the price of Bitburger, and we calculate that for this product, and this is a discount because we, the logistic discount, this is 25 per barrel, yeah, and this is the price we use. And you don't know in every that's a special in my installation. We for the beer we also have a product for the barrel that we can take back. This is deposit for the barrel, so you don't have to know about that. But this is the price we calculated. This is like a checksum of my code. That's not in the end product, yeah? So I can see what that is, and when I have several products in the invoice, I can see the calculation for every single product.
You're not going through a purchase order here, when you order from your suppliers, you're just entering the invoice directly?
No, I'm coming from when you use it, you use it in the purchase order and in the invoice. That's just an example. Yeah, we use it very much in customer prices, mm-hmm. but I did that with vendors for the example here. Okay. Yeah, let's see at something more interesting. So the next part is a small barrel of Bitburger. This is 30 liters. And you would expect the beer is the same and has the same price. So it says we have the price, but the price is calculated for 30 liters. We have the logistic discount calculated for 30 liters. And you see the upper line, that is, this line has no comment. I did not enter a good comment here. This line says a 30-liter beer is like a 50-liter beer. Take the same price. Yeah. So with a good comment here, you can see why the 30-liter beer has this price, because it is the same price as a 50-liter beer. The next step is to look at Köstritzer. You see there is an additional cost for Köstritzer because the freight, but it has the same price as Bitburger, and Bitburger has a logistic discount and Bitburger has a price. And we add all that to this price. Yeah? Because I changed things, that's not the same as here, but that's the price that should be here. Okay. If you want to see how that works, we can have a look at the condition window. These are the conditions we had. These are conditions for coffee. These are the conditions we talked about. The most easy thing is this is the base price. And this is the whole monster. Yeah, you see the product with this business partner has a fixed price of 135 per hectoliter. I divided the system into special cases. I think it can use hundreds of cases. But I have identified 18 cases in my company. And one case is this price, a vendor price. Yeah, and there are rules that a vendor price uses several fields and not the other. And it has a special stage and a sequence number that is to order things that stack each other. And and the whole thing is date. You can use dates and don't have to delete older records when the prices change. So it can use an invoice from last month has another price than an invoice from this month. I check when I check if I did it right, it's very easy to do things wrong and screw up everything. But when I did it right, it explains a category that is a vendor twice. So when I enter something here or here and I do something wrong that does not belong to a vendor price, it should change the category or make it red or throw an alert or something. What I also did for my employees is I translated, this is a machine translation of the whole condition to explain what it is. And this is special to this category, so it says that is the vendor Bitburger Brewery sells us this product for the price of that. That helps my employees to understand what the whole thing does, because it's quite complex. Yeah, the main problem in our company is the complexity of that, and that's very easy to do things wrong. And let's show another example, that's interesting. That is the freight of Köstritzer, and now I want to know which products belong to Köstritzer, and because it's one vendor, one brewery, and I don't know what is Bitburger and what is Köstritzer, I used a classification for that. So in the product field, in the product record, there is a classification field, and I can classify things as Köstritzer. So some vendors have products for restaurants and products for point of sale for normal people, and they give special discounts for restaurant products. So I can write an R here for restaurant and can have a discount only on these special things, yeah? Or a vendor gives a discount for a brand that is new, yeah? Like Coca-Cola has new products every year, and we can have a discount for the new products. You see no product here. So this is like a database filter. Yeah, and here also you see that's a different category and a different way of translating that to human language. Perhaps a third example is when something has the same price, that's quite easy. It's a type of same as, and the Köstritzer product has the same price as Bitburger product. You can also say that a business partner has the same prices as another business partner. So when a restaurant owner has two restaurants, he has the same prices for both of them. I can do that too. And that are different categories. There is something wrong configured here. But in theory, that should explain the thing. Yeah. I think that's how I did it. And I can show you another example. What we can do, that is, I told you the brewery adds a discount of 2%. That is 2%, no amount here, for the whole brewery. And it's a percentage. I deactivated it by date, so let's do it this year. So when I recalculate the Köstritzer, product. Product. That was my example here to show the classification. Yeah, you know that field. That's an standard IDMPF field. So when I redo the calculation, we see the Köstritzer price. It is still as it is, and that's a barrel okay, it's still there. But we have that are the product lines, the sum of the product lines. And then starting, we have document lines. That means document conditions. Here we have a discount of 81 cent. That is a 2% discount on this product. But we have it here to see it in one number. And when you have the document from the vendor and you want to control that, you see that number and you can see if it fits or not. But the price that we use here is that price minus that. So for our calculation, we use the real price we paid, but we have something to control the invoice and to know where it belongs. Yeah. I do that with print. I call it printing levels. I can have several levels of printing. And it is possible, it's an idea to have like three levels. One level for a price, one level that can be shown on the invoice for the customer. So my customer, when he says, I have a discount for Bitburger and the brewery wanted to give me that, I don't give him a price that is lower, but I give him the higher price and can tell him the discount. So he sees, I have a discount, and he's happy. But IDMPR only knows about the end price. I didn't want to make this more complicated because I see no worth in changing all these things. The question is to know how it comes, but not to change IDMPR.
Why do you have more than two decimals behind the comma? You're operating, these are euro amounts, right?
Yes. That's configurable. I use that when you use discounts, it's better to have some numbers more. Like when you do 2% on a bottle price, you get crazy. It will not fit. It's a question of rounding. Yeah, at the end. We take these prices, yeah. But you can configure it, or it takes, I don't know, it takes, it looks into the price list of the customer and of the business partner, and you can configure how many.
And this one here, this thing in the middle, that's an iframe field, or?
No, that's an... an HTML field, and it is constructed by a SQL formula.
Okay.
Writing HTML in SQL is quite strange, but I did it this way. It was just to show how to do it. I think that can be done much better in Java, and but I'm still not sure how to do it and where to show it and how to, what's the best way to show that to the to the user.
As I understood, the name of this is a register on accounting level. So how do you can may show us the accounting of the invoice?
No, nothing changed. That is normal IDMPR with normal accounting.
So are you able to make a sum of your discount of this or that at the end of the year?
Yeah.
So now
I am not in the accounting.
Not in accounting,
yeah. But it's possible to pick that up if you like, yeah.
Also,
so you can you know about the fields we have here, like list price, discount price, and things like that. And you can in principle, you can have a formula, a different formula for every field, and you can fill it with some value calculated on a different stage or whatever that belongs to your use case and how exactly you want it.
Only in the HTML after the
yeah.
SQL query, so
yeah.
It's not
not accounted. I had some arguments with Carlos about the whole thing. He didn't like it. And he convinced me that the best idea is not to change too much. So what I do is basically that I fill these values like a user does it, and nothing more. Yeah, it's a bit different, but not, in principle, we changed the questioning of the price list. Yeah, that's like a dynamic price list. Yeah, that's, I think that's the best explanation. Yeah?
It would be interesting to know how much at the end of a certain period we are giving a discount in terms of each condition that we have.
Yeah, the information is there. It's a question of bringing it all together. I think you can do that, but the easiest way is to fill the fields the right way. And to say you have given a list price and you can change list price and entered price, yeah? That's, I think that's the best way to do that. And the system, you know, you see that we have different stages, and the system would allow to have some conditions that belong to the list price field and some conditions that belong to the discount field, yeah? Because I don't know, the freight is not a discount. So you can decide, do you want to use that condition if you fill the price list field or if you fill the entered field?
So yeah. You can extend the dictionary and add those fields down?
Add?
Add those fields down, the fields of the discount.
Yeah, you can use. Do you know the normal fields in the invoice? Yeah, you can use them and fill them. If you like to add more fields for several discounts, that's another thing. Yeah, but in principle, it is just a way to get things out of the condition database that can be quite complicated and have numbers at the point where you like it. And I think how to extract data belongs to your business case.
Thomas, well, pricing is a complicated topic, of course. And you can have several approaches to do this. But why didn't you use standard promotion, for example, or standard price schema in IDMPR? Well, discount schema. Maybe this can be built on these tools.
I thought about it, and I started with a list of the 18 cases I have, and I thought how fit these cases into IDMPR, and yeah, at the end I decided to start from scratch. And I tried to do it in a way that yeah, it can do everything. So I didn't have 18 cases at the start, I had like 12 or 13, and then I realized we have more, and it was quite easy to add things.
Yeah, but promotions is something that calculates is all the lines in the middle, yeah? Promotions. So it's not the case for Thomas,
In theory, it's possible to use that and fill the standard tables. Yeah.
There's precondition.
So when
table there in promotion.
When you don't want to touch code.
Promotions usually you have a price and then you have lines with discounts.
Okay.
What Thomas wants is to have a complex way to calculate the final price.
And final entry, one entry of the
yeah.
Track, right? Mm-hmm. And based on variable.
Yeah.
If you have the requirement to deduct some discount at the end of the invoice, which is a good line,
A discount at the end of the invoice?
Like you have five products calculated in this way and then overall you have some...
Yeah, that's here the... That is a sconto. Yeah, but yeah, that was no. I know what you want to. No, I don't have that. But that's an idea that I don't know if we want this 2%, for example, not included here in that price, but have a new line for that. But yeah, I don't need that. But that's something that can be done. Yeah, you can pick up that value of the whole invoice and create it using a callout also. Okay. More questions? Yeah. There is still a lot to do. I work with that since 2 years, so it works for my case, but you have seen it's still not finished, and I like to have people telling me how to do, or if people say that has a worse, to do it for community, do it in a better way, we can clean it up. There are many places in IDMPR that need values, that have values, and a problem we have is when you open when you enter a product and you open the product info window because you want to search something. You need a price list. Products without a price list do not show up there. So we need to set prices in the price list just for fun. We don't need them, but we enter them because IDMPR uses it this way. So there are some things in IDMPR that do not fit. For us, for our case, we work with that and we can fix all these problems, but when we want to do a plugin for that, we need to search for all places where prices or calculations or amounts are used. I'm still not sure how to show that information. I think the HTML is quite a good idea, but there may be printouts or more help for the users. What you say, the discounts in a period or things like that, I'm working on that to have performance data from that to calculate, to improve my business. That's what it was about. Yeah, that's it. If you don't have more questions, thanks.